Hello, students of Dynamics. This is Dr. Dan Baker with another lecture in our rigid body motion series. And this is going to focus on relative velocity. This time, a little bit more complicated relative velocity, which would include either slipping between moving bodies or also with rotating axes. We can take a look at it in two different frameworks. I'll try to cover both. I'll tend to use the slipping as being kind of the primary, and then also talk a bit about how you could think about this with rotating axes. All right, so I'm going to show the application of this concept with two different types of systems. One of those is going to be a four-bar linkage. All right, so for a four-bar linkage, we are going to have now some slipping going on between two bodies that are both moving. So the system's going to look like this. So we're going to have a pin down here, call this point O. Another pin over here on this side, call this point A. There's going to be a slotted member coming up in this direction. Now the slot is going to run along the length of that member like this. And then I'll go ahead and draw this one in blue just so we can kind of contrast those two. And then another member that's going to come up and come across this other member. So this pin that's on the blue body, we're going to label this pin, pin B. And then additionally, I'm going to add a couple more points onto the other body. One I'll put out here on the end. Let's call this point C, just kind of this far end of this rigid body. And then the last point that we're going to put in, I'll go ahead and zoom in to take a look at this one, is going to be a marker point, which is on body AC, but is the current location of point B. Okay, so this is on two separate bodies. Let me go ahead and draw a little diagram of each one of these just so we can see what they look like. So we have kind of a scaled down version here of the blue body. So this is O and B. And then the black body that's interacting with, we called the end here C. We said the pin down here at this end is A. And within the slot down the middle, we have a marker point, point P. Okay, so the reason I kind of drew that staggered on either side of the slot is just to show that it is the exact same location at this instant as point B. So to give you a little more physical reality of this system, let me go ahead and switch over to a different video feed here where we'll take a look at a Lego model of this same system. So you can see here in this Lego model, here's point O, a point of fixed axis rotation. Here's point A, another point of fixed axis rotation. Here's point P, right, which is on body AC right here. And there's point B, which is the collar right on top of P. And then there's C. As we rotate body OB, you can see that both bodies have to move, right? The system is in constrained motion. You can see right here that P moves away from B, or you can also think about it as B moving away from point P. Okay, there's a relative departure velocity or a slipping velocity between these two points. So using this information, let's go ahead and write an equation that fundamentally is going to help us find this slipping velocity, also absolute velocities of point P, absolute velocity of point B. So that equation looks like the following. We can say that our velocity of B is equal to the velocity of A plus a relative velocity, velocity of P relative to A, plus the final term is going to be the slipping velocity, the velocity of B relative to P. Now, a couple notes to make on this equation. One of those notes is to always select the point for the left-hand side of your equation, which is adjacent to P. And then everything over on the right side of the equation basically builds out to P, so builds to P plus the slipping away from P. Right, and that's really this last term here, this slipping term, as B departs from P. So this is really just building upon our relative motion that we've been doing all chapter with these rigid body systems. We've just added another term, and do note that if we take that same approach to multiplying subscripts, that if we have B over on the left and all the subscripts, the product of them on the right is going to be A times P over A times B over P. So we can cross-check this by canceling P, canceling A, and we're left with B equals B, which tells me that I picked the right order, the right terms for that system. All right, so the next step that we can do is we can actually draw all of these vectors in this equation on the diagram over on the left-hand side here. So we do need something to start with. Let's say that on this problem we're given a omega of OB, it can be negative from the right-hand rule. Knowing omega of OB is in that direction, if I map out onto here, so perpendicular to OB, I would have a velocity coming here, the velocity of B. Now, if OB is moving over that direction and we're given all these different angles, then you should be able to observe that at this instant, AC also needs to move over to the right. Now, you could label this as either omega of AC, you could label it as omega of AP, you could also label it as the omega of APC, right? All three of those points are on the same body. And so I won't clutter it with a position vector here, but we could write a position vector going from point A up to point P, as we're worried about finding this velocity over here of P relative to A. So looking at that term, and if we have a negative omega, that means we need perpendicular to that arm. This would be a velocity of P relative to A. Let's look at our slipping velocity. So the slipping velocity is going to be how point P departs from point B. And you can think if we rotate this in a negative right-hand rule direction, rotating OB, that basically B is going to move down toward point A as P relatively moves away from it. Okay, so if we go ahead and label this, if we're looking at B relative to P, it's going to be down along this arm. And we call that the velocity of B relative to P. Now, this last slipping velocity can be challenging to conceptualize. One nice thing about it, as all these problems are going to require vector algebra, you can guess a direction of this velocity vector. If you get it wrong, you'll just get a negative magnitude value from your algebra, just like we've had other instances in both statics and dynamics. We guess something if we don't know a direction, and we get a negative value if we're incorrect. And so if you had guessed that V of B relative to P was going up the arm, you get a negative value for that magnitude. So cross-checking what we've drawn on the left diagram with our equation over on the right, we can see that we've drawn this velocity of P relative to A. We've drawn the slipping velocity of B relative to P. We have drawn the absolute velocity of B. So all of those are spatially defined. The last term we have is the velocity of A. As we can see, A is a fixed axis pin, therefore this goes to zero. And you'll find out that on many of these four-bar linkage problems, in constrained motion, we cannot have really any velocity at A. If we did, we basically have to have an additional linkage in there, then it becomes more than 1 degree of freedom. So essentially, it becomes a non-predictive moving system. And so this is really common in a four-bar linkage to have this absolute velocity on the right-hand side go away, but we just wanted to add it in there initially to make sure that we got all of our subscripts to work out. All right, now looking at this same overall system for a additive motion case. So you might remember from previous videos that additive motion is looking at one body moving and then another body moving relative to that body. They're kind of attached together. So here will be the system we'll analyze for additive motion. It will start here with a pin. We'll have an angled member going up here to the right, call this O and A. We'll have a pin here at A, which is attached to a currently vertical member. We'll call this AC. And then the last piece that we'll have going on is there's going to be a collar, call this collar B, which is actually sliding along arm AC. Okay, so hopefully you can see here why we need that additional relative velocity term. Without collar B, we could handle the motion of this system with simply the relative velocity of two points on the same body. We could pick those points as A and C, and we'd be off to the races. But if we're looking for the absolute velocity here of B, we do need to add that marker point once again. In this case, the marker point is going to be lying underneath the collar. So this is going to be called point P. So just to draw out these bodies, I'll just focus on the collar and body AC. So if here is AC, we have a marker point here, which is P. And then the collar itself doesn't have point P on it. We can call the location of that dot point B. Okay, so we have this blue collar, and the blue collar is moving relative to the other member. So once again, a quick physical model of this system. So we can see here this is point O, this is point A attaching these two bodies together. This is my collar, and we can see that collar moves up and down, and underneath it is point P. Okay, so the collar can slide up and down, and currently at this instant, it is right over the top of point P. So as we move this arm, move arm OA, you can see that the outer arm moves with it. We can also move the outer arm AC relative to OA. And then the third thing that we have moving is the collar along that arm. So that's our slipping velocity of B relative to P. And so as we write these equations for our additive motion system, the key here is we're going to want to start with this point that is adjacent to P. It's most convenient to write that on the left-hand side of our equation. So VB is going to be equal to, this is a vector equation, and we're going to add together the velocity of A plus a relative velocity between P and A. So that's the velocity of P relative to A, plus the velocity, the slipping velocity of B relative to P. Now, once again, as we look at these subscripts, if we multiply them through, we end up with B equals B. So let's go ahead and draw these vectors and talk a little bit more about the angular velocity as well. Let's assume on this problem that my given omega of OA is going negative from the right-hand rule. If that's the case, I'll end up with a velocity of A, which is perpendicular to that arm. And then as I'm trying to find my relative velocity of P relative to A, I do need to know my absolute angular velocity of AC. Okay, so there's two ways this could be designated. It could either be given to you as an absolute, or often it's given to you as a relative angular velocity. So it'll tell you how quickly AC is rotating relative to point A. But point A, of course, is also moving. And so to find this overall omega, let's say in this problem that we find the total omega of AC absolute is positive from the right-hand rule. We can write this as our omega of AC. Of course, we also call that AP, call it APC, any of those work. It's going to equal the sum of our omega of OA plus this relative omega of AC relative to OA. Now we could write that as a vector equation, we could write it as a scalar, because all of our rotation on a two-dimensional problem is in the k hat direction, which we do need to assign the positive and negative from the right-hand rule. And so given that we found, or we're assuming on this problem, a positive right-hand rule omega ac, it would turn out that this term is going to be bigger than our absolute omega of OA in order to overcome its originally negative sign from the right-hand rule to end up with omega AC with an overall negative angular velocity. Okay, and so with that angular velocity, we can find that this velocity here, my velocity of P relative to A, so we've taken care of A, taken care of P relative to A, the last thing we need is this slipping velocity. And typically this has to be given to you some kind of information about how this is moving, because you'll notice in additive motion, unlike four-bar linkages, the motion isn't constrained enough to tell what direction that would have to be moving in. So let's say in this problem that my B is moving relative to P down toward point A. So we could label this one the velocity of B relative to P. And so that would take care of our three vectors on the right-hand side. So all of these we can draw before we compute the problem. The unique thing about additive motion is that we can't find the direction of VB until we're done computing everything else. Now, spatially, you can actually think that the velocity of B absolute is going to be the sum of this vector, right, VA, plus the horizontal vector here, P relative to A, plus this B relative to P. And so we could tell at this point that definitely the velocity of B absolute must be going down, and it would just depend on the horizontal components of VA versus V of P relative to A, whether it's going down a little bit left or a little bit right. But we need to compute that first before we can solve for that direction. One thing I did want to mention before I sign off is thinking about these rotating axes. So it turns out that if you're going to use the rotating axes construct, which is used by R.C. Hibbler in his textbooks, that P is the origin of a rotating slash moving axis. Okay, so we can think on this problem here fundamentally that my point P, which is on arm AC, I'll go ahead and just draw it over here, is the origin of this moving coordinate system. And that coordinate system would actually rotate with body AC. And it'd be the same thing here, that this point P, I'll do this one in gray, would be the origin of a X prime Y prime moving axis system. Like I said, it's anchored there to point P. So you can either use the axis system as your reference, or you can use point P, and as things are slipping or moving away from point P, either framework works, but find one that works for you. Thanks for your attention today, and I hope everything's going well.